Okay. You know what? This man once famously said that what is wrong with the French is that they don't have the word for entrepreneurship. Of course, that you know that that's a French word, entrepreneurship. But you know that so yes, that he didn't get it quite right. But what he said actually reflects a common Anglo-American prejudice against France as an undynamic and laid-back country full of meddling bureaucrats, pompous waiters, and sheep-burning farmers. You know, they think, oh, yeah, the French people enjoy their life, have a long lunch, and you know, they don't work. Now, as I'll tell you in a minute, this conception of France is actually completely wrong, but the perspective behind this statement is actually quite widely accepted. You know, people all agree that you need entrepreneurial people to have a successful economy. So in this kind of view, the poverty of the developing countries is attributed to the lack of entrepreneurship. So when people from rich countries go to a developing country and come across a scene like this, they say, aha, I know why this country is poor. You know, look at all those men sitting in a cafe, having 11 cups of mint tea every day, you know, piping away in their hookah. You know, this country needs entrepreneurs. You know? People need to go and make money. You know? That's how they will become rich. Of course, these people don't know what they are talking about. Because if you are from a developing country, or if you at least lived in a developing country for an extended period, we'll know that these are scenes that are more typical of developing countries. You know, thousands, tens of thousands of millions of people trying to sell everything that you can think of, and even things that you didn't know could be sold. Let me give you an example. When I first went to South Africa in 1991, I think, a friend of mine took me to a restaurant. So he parked his car, we got out of the car, and suddenly some guy appeared on our side saying, oh, let me take care of your car. And my friend said, yeah, do that, and gave him money. So I said, what are you doing? You know, this guy, what is he going to do? And my friend said, oh, no, no. You know, what he means is that if you don't pay me, I'll slash your tire while you're eating. So I have to pay him. You know, when I was a young man in South Korea, if you wanted to get a visa interview at the American embassy, you had to queue. There's no system of kind of going through answering machines and internet registration, so you actually had to be there physically. And of course, there was a long queue. So this created some, well, this new, well, not so new, but the interesting category of profession, which I can only describe as the professional cure. So what you do is you wake up at 4:30 in the morning, you go and line up in front of the American embassy. And come 8:45, some guy in a nice suit comes and says, well, your spot looks very nice. Do you mind selling it to me? And of course, you're not going to sell it that easily. So you say, oh, you know, I have an uncle who lives in America. He's very sick. I have to go and see him. You know, I'm not going to sell this. But the guy in the suit has a lot of money, so he'll offer, how about $200? No, 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 no. My uncle's going to die next week. Yeah? How about $500? Okay, well, maybe he'll survive another few days. So give me the money. Yeah, and you have made your the wage for the week. You know, like this, I mean, in developing countries, they are full of people who are desperate to make money. And they come up with all kinds of wonderful ideas about creating income. In contrast, most citizens of rich countries have not even come near to becoming an entrepreneur. You know, most of them work for companies which sometimes employ tens of thousands of people, hundreds of thousands of people, and they all do very highly specialized jobs. You know, I once read about this engineer in General Motors who spent his entire career designing locks for the door handle. And he had no idea how the door was made, not to speak of the car. So they are very specialized. And in the process, what do? They realize someone else's entrepreneurial vision. Well, in fact, if you compare the numbers, where are the numbers? Yeah, here. No, there's between 2 and 13 times higher chance of someone from a developing country being an entrepreneur compared to someone from a rich country. So if you're from Norway, only less than 7% of people are entrepreneurs in the sense that they own their own business. If you're from Benin, 89% of people own their own business. Of course, these businesses will be the small farm, you know, the stores that are selling the small things, but you know, they'll be running their own shop. So actually, on average, the people from developing countries are far more entrepreneurial than people from developed countries. And in this, you know, really, there's no difference between the United States and France. You know, if anything, the French people are more entrepreneurial because only 7.5% of Americans have their own business, whereas in France, the ratio is 8.6%. So what was George Bush talking about? Yeah? You know, this is completely based on wrong perception, but, you know, even if France is a bit more entrepreneurial, it's basically more or less the same as the United States. Compared to Ghana, Bangladesh, they are not even half entrepreneurial. Now, if you see these figures, we'll naturally ask this question. Okay, so people are far more entrepreneurial in the developing countries, then why they are poor? Well, the most popular answer to this in the recent period has been that these people lack credits. You know, when you want to start business, you need credit. You have to buy raw material, you have to hire workers before you can even start a business. So in the last 10 years, 15 years, there's been a very popular movement called the microfinance movement, which involves lending very small sums of money, maybe $20, maybe $100, to poor people in developing countries so that they can use it to start their own business and stand on their own feet. So many of you know that in, I think, 2006 or something like that, this the microfinance bank in Bangladesh called the Grameen Bank, and its founder, Dr. Muhammad Yunus, got a Nobel Peace Prize, in recognition of the fact that this was, you know, pulling people out of poverty, more importantly, helping people pull themselves out of poverty with their own entrepreneurial energy. But increasingly, evidence is coming out that the spread of microfinance actually has done very little to lift people out of poverty on a permanent basis. Well, there are many reasons behind this, but one of the reasons is that the interest rates charged on these loans are very high. I mean, Grameen Bank charges 30-40%, which you might already think is quite high, but there are microfinance banks in Mexico charging over 100%. in countries like Nigeria, there are the microfinance banks that charge 200% interest rate. Yeah? You know, you cannot make money with that kind of interest rate. Yeah? But that's only one of the problem. The other more important problem is the low productive capabilities of the individuals taking on these microfinance loans. Let me explain a bit. You know, back in 1997, the Grameen Bank teamed up with Telenor, the state-owned telephone company of Norway. And the Grameen Bank got this mobile phone handset at a low price from Telenor and lent money to these ladies in the poor rural villages to buy this phone. Yeah, so these phones, people in Spain or Korea or England would have had no problem buying. But you know, for Bangladesh people, this was a very expensive thing because at the time, the country's per capita income was about $300. Huh? So even if the phone was only $50, that's like a 2 month income per person. So the Grameen Bank lent money to these ladies, and these so-called telephone ladies initially made a huge amount of money. Because at the time, most Bangladesh villages didn't have any telephone. So people went to them, went to these telephone ladies, paid a small amount of money, used the mobile phone to make phone calls. Huh? And these ladies made somewhere between $750 and $1,200 per year on this phone renting business. Yeah? It was a really good business. In a country with $300 per capita income, you are making 2.5, 3, 4 times national average income. Yeah? Unfortunately, since this was so profitable, many ladies wanted to do this. And after a while, there were so many telephone ladies, they had no business. They couldn't make money. So by 2005, there were so many telephone ladies that their average income per year fell to $70. In the meantime, Bangladesh's national average income went up to $450. Yeah? So instead of making 4 times national income, average national income, now these ladies were making less than one quarter of national income. So what went wrong? Well, what went wrong was that there was over competition. There were too many people trying to make a living by renting phones. And given this, you would say, yeah, of course, they should have should not have all got into the same business and created new business. Yeah? If you cannot make money renting phones, why don't you write software for phone games? Yeah? Why don't you manufacture phones? Yeah? Of course, you would have already realized how absurd these situations is. The suggestions are. Yeah? Because these the poor ladies in Bangladesh have no chance of doing anything else. Yeah? Cambodia is another country with a lot of microfinance banks. And someone told me, I haven't been there, but someone told me that in the Phnom Penh, the capital city, there are so many people selling noodles on the street with this micro loan that they got from microfinance banks. There are more people who sell noodles than people who can eat the noodles. Eh? So these examples show that microfinance has failed to work because there's only a limited range of businesses that these poor individuals in developing countries can take on because they have very low productive capabilities. And one of the few businesses, those few businesses that they can get into, like selling noodles or renting mobile phones out, become very quickly crowded. And I would argue that this short story about microfinance is very symptomatic of the current state of discourse on economic development. You know, until the 1970s, there was actually a general consensus that economic development is essentially about transforming the abilities to produce, or productive capabilities for short. Of course, people had a huge debate on how to achieve it. So people on the right, like Walt Rostow, said if you follow basically American model, developing countries will industrialize and become developed. Yeah. At the other extreme, the dependency theorists argue that you need to break away from the world capitalist system, stage a nationalist socialist revolution. That's the only way to develop. But no one really questioned that development requires developing the capabilities to produce, especially the manufactured products. Well, most of us still hold this view at the instinctive level. So for example, despite the fact that some of the rich oil states like Dubai or Brunei have a very high income, we refuse to call them developed countries because we have this view that implicitly at least, achieving high income through resource bonanza is not economic development. For the opposite kind of example, after the end of the Second World War, per capita income in Germany fell to the level of Mexico and Peru. But no one suggested that from now on we have to reclassify Germany as a developing country because their income is at the same level as that of Mexico. People knew that Germany still had necessary productive capabilities to regain its pre-war level of living standard quickly, and that's why they didn't reclassify Germany as a developing country, and indeed, Germany recovered the pre-war level of income within 10 years. This is known as the miracle on the Rhine. So these examples show that we are implicitly saying that economic development is about the ability to produce rather than simply about command over income or resources. Having money is not enough. It's how you got the money. However, during the last three decades, the dominant view of development has become that economic development is basically about poverty reduction and the more widespread provision of basic needs. I mean, the most representative of this is, I should have shown you this, is the so-called MDGs, Millennium Development Goals. I mean, of course, that from next year, we are going to replace them with the SDGs, or Sustainable Development Goals, and I'm quite happy to hear that in the SDGs, this the issues of productive capabilities and employment and things like that are going to be included. But at the moment, as it stands, MDGs has hardly anything about production. It's all about poverty reduction, providing better health and education. Of course, all very important goals. But this is not what we used to mean by economic development. So the development discourse has been radically changed in the last three decades. And I argue that behind this radical transformation have been three important intellectual trends. One is neoliberalism. This is the economic doctrine that believes that the best economic policies are basically slightly updated version of the 19th century liberal policy of laissez-faire. Okay, neoliberals, unlike the 19th century liberals, would accept a slightly bigger role for the government. For example, in the 19th century, the liberals were against having a central bank. They thought no one should have monopoly over money issue. Neoliberals actually say that having a good central bank is important. So it's not completely the same, but basically it's that this idea that laissez-faire policy is the best policy. And this doctrine has been, as you know, extremely influential in the last 3-4 decades. Well, I mean, Spain's at the moment suffering from it. Yeah. I don't need to remind you that. And why does neoliberalism lead to a neglect of production? First of all, neoliberalism is not synonymous with neoclassical economics. I mean, this relationship is quite complex, so I'm not going to go into that. It's not synonymous with neoclassical economics, but it is at its core is neoclassical economics. And neoclassical economics is basically about market exchange and has little to say about production. Yeah, so there's something called production function. But it's a very mechanical relationship between some abstract quanta called capital and another abstract quanta called labor. There's no issue about how to organize production, how you discipline the workers, how you organize inventory and all these things. Because that neoclassical economists see the world as a series of market exchange. And production is only in the background. It's something that happens somehow. It's something that other people should worry about, like business school people and maybe engineers. But it's not our job. Well, so much so that the 1992 Nobel Economics Prize winner, Ronald Coase, who is by no means against neoclassical economics, criticized neoclassical economics for being about lone individuals exchanging nuts and berries on the edge of a forest. He's basically saying this is a very primitive exchange economy that they are describing in neoclassical economics. So neoclassical economics doesn't have a very good theory of production, and it is natural that it gets neglected in its policy discussion. Secondly, in the neoclassical economic theory, the issue surrounding the development of productive capabilities actually assumed away as it takes these capabilities as given. You know, in the neoclassical trade theory, for example, the so-called Heckscher-Ohlin-Samuelson model, named after two Swedish economists, Elie Heckscher and Bertil Ohlin, and the American economist Paul Samuelson, who developed David Ricardo's idea of comparative advantage in a different direction. In that theory, which is the foundation of neoclassical trade theory, all countries are assumed to have the same capabilities to use any technology. What distinguishes country is only their factor endowment. Some countries have more capital than labor, other countries have more labor than capital in proportional terms. So countries with relatively more capital should specialize in products that use technologies that are more capital intensive, like say automobile. Countries with a lot of labor should specialize in labor intensive products, like garment. But in that theory, if a country like Guatemala is not producing, say, things like BMWs, it's not because it cannot. Because the ability to use different technologies are assumed to be all the same. It doesn't produce BMWs only because it is not economical to do so. So this crucial issue in economic development, namely the ability to use more sophisticated technologies, the ability to use more complex division of labor and organize production in general, is assumed away from the beginning. Yeah? And of course, third, believing in the power of the free market. The neoliberal discourse criticizes any attempt to deliberately enhance productive capabilities through public policy intervention as being at best futile and at worst counterproductive. So a lot of countries have used what is known as infant industry protection. This is the government of an economically backward country deliberately protecting and subsidizing its young producers until they grow up, like children grow up, and can compete with superior producers from abroad. This idea has been used repeatedly. The practice was actually invented in Britain in the 18th century. The theory was invented in America by none other than the first Treasury Secretary or the Finance Minister of the United States called Alexander Hamilton. This is the theory that the Germans used, that the Swedes used, the Japanese used, the Koreans used, and so on to develop their economies. But these kind of things are basically, I mean, from the beginning, assumed to be counterproductive. Now, another second intellectual trend behind the decline of interest in the production has come from the left of the political spectrum. Since the 1980s, there's been what could be described as a humanist reaction against the standard development economics of 1960s and 70s. And these humanists argue that the early development economics had this collectivist and materialistic biases. You know, the early development theories of the 1940s, 50s, and 60s were mainly about the transforming the productive structure through policies affecting aggregate variables like investment, labor supply, and things like that at the aggregate level. And in applying these theories, individuals were forgotten or worse, repressed in the name of the greater good called economic development. And the humanists said that this is wrong. You have to take individuals seriously, and it made them emphasize the need to enhance individual capabilities through health, education, and empowerment, as we see in the MDGs. Finally, there was a third intellectual trend that made us neglect production, and this is the so-called post-industrial discourse. You know, according to this view, rising income has rising income has brought about the shift of demand towards services, making material production increasingly less important. So the share of manufacturing is declining, both in terms of output and employment in all developed countries. And this is the trend of the future. Making things doesn't matter anymore. It's a low-grade activity that the Chinese and the Vietnamese and the people like those should do. And the proponents of this argument cite cases like Switzerland and Singapore as examples of service-based prosperity. You know, look at Singapore, look at Switzerland. They show that you can become very rich on the basis of service activities like banking and tourism and logistics. They also talk about the case of India, which is supposed to show that even developing countries can succeed in services. You know, India has had quite a bit of success in exporting services. And in this process, the issue of productive development is almost completely ignored, because it is implicitly assumed that even the poorest countries possess the capability to compete in services. Yeah, so, okay, I mean, building cars is important, but any country can run call centers. That's the kind of thinking behind it. Okay, now let me critically examine these arguments, because correctly understanding what's going on in these areas is crucial in improving our understanding of development. Well, first of all, regarding the neoliberal view, there's ample evidence showing that industrialization is necessary for economic development, showing also that industrialization doesn't happen automatically through market forces. Well, first, the kind of evidence is the fact that neoliberal policies have failed to generate economic development in the last three decades. And this is true even if you define economic development narrowly as economic growth. Yeah? Never mind whether you are upgrading your technology and so on. Let's just simply look at growth figures. Well, from here you will. I'm particularly focusing on Latin America and Sub-Saharan Africa here because these are two regions that have practiced these neoliberal policies most diligently because they were under structural adjustment program, but from the IMF and the World Bank. No, Latin American countries in the so-called bad old days of import substitution, in per capita terms, used to grow at 3.1% between the 1960s and the 70s. Even Sub-Saharan Africa, which didn't do as well as other regions, were growing at 1.6%. Well, actually, you cannot see that here because Sub-Saharan Africa is here divided between middle-income countries and low-income countries. This is an old World Bank classification, but I mean, I've done the separate calculation and the average between these the two is at 1.6. In the next 30 years, growth basically evaporated these regions. I mean, it was even worse in the 1980s and 90s. I mean, the per capita income fell at the rate of 0.7% per year for 20 years in Sub-Saharan Africa. Yeah? It was basically stagnant in Latin America at 0.3%. Between 2000 and 2010, the economic growth picked up in these regions a bit, but averaged over 30 years between 1980 and 2010, per capita income growth in Latin America was one quarter of what it used to be, 0.8%. And the Sub-Saharan African income is, was growing at one-eighth the speed of what it used to, that is 0.2% per year against 1.6% per year. You know, if you are growing at 0.2% per year, after 30 years, your income is 6% higher than what it was 30 years ago. You know, in a good year, China grows that much in 6 months. Yeah? And so this is at the scale of failure. And of course, as you see, I mean, there was some increase in economic growth in the 2000s, but unfortunately, a lot of this is due to commodity boom, driven by Chinese economic growth rather than the development in productive capabilities. So this is now kind of becoming very difficult to sustain with the falling commodity prices and the slowing down of the Chinese economy. So that's the more recent evidence, but another type of evidence comes from history. As I try to show in these books, Kicking the Ladder and Bad Samaritans, almost all of today's rich countries, including Britain in the 18th century, the United States in the 19th century, Sweden, Germany, Japan, Korea, Taiwan, they all developed by using state intervention like trade protectionism, industrial subsidies, state-owned enterprises, and regulation of foreign direct investments. I cannot go into the details, but you know the evidence is just staggering. Well, I mean that the scale of this misrepresentation of history is most evident in the case of the United States. I just told you that the theory of infant industry protection was invented by the first finance minister of the country. The United States, until the Second World War, for about 120 years, had the highest average industrial tariff rate in the world. Okay, I mean, there are some periods when, for example, the Franco raised Spanish manufacturing tariff rate in the 1930s. It was a bit higher than the American rate, yeah? And so on. So there were some exceptions, but almost throughout that 120 years, the United States was the most protectionist country in the world. Yeah? And we have been brainwashed to believe that that's the country that succeeded because of free trade. Yeah? Well, how about the humanists? Well, the problem with this group is that, you know, it's not that it is not interested in raising productive capabilities. It is, yeah? But the problem is that the humanists try to do it mainly by making individuals more capable by investing in their health and education. Yeah? There's no recognition that a lot of productive development happens actually at the enterprise level. Yeah? Also, in addition to development of development of productive capabilities at the enterprise level rather than at the individual level, economic development requires a series of collective institutions that encourage and help different economic actors work together. So what kind of capital labor relationship do you create? Yeah? What kind of cooperation that you create among firms within and across different sectors? What kind of government business interaction do you create? What kind of partnership between industry and the academia you create? All these things really matter in determining the productive capabilities of a country. Unfortunately, the humanists do not really talk about this. Yeah? Having clever individuals is not enough. Yeah? You know, what really distinguishes, I don't know, the United States or Germany from, say, Nigeria and the Philippines is not their economists, not their engineers. Yeah? It's the presence of these the giant firms like Boeing and Volkswagen and all the institutions that surround them to help them develop their productive capabilities. Eh? No, just think about it. I mean, that when you import an engineer from Nigeria or the Philippines into Germany, their productivity goes up like that. Eh? Because they are now working with much better technology, much better institutions. It's not because people are stupid that these countries are poor. Eh? There are all these collective institutions, you know, ranging from productive enterprises, to government business relationship, to mechanisms of collaboration between the industry and the academia that determine productivity of these individuals. So the neglect of these collective dimensions of capabilities, productive capabilities, is a very important gap in the humanist tradition, because most of them who operate in the tradition think mainly at the individual level. That's not enough. That's important. That's the necessary, but that's not enough. Then how about the post-industrial economy discourse? Well, first of all, the increasing share of services in output actually does not mean that material production is not important anymore. We are in fact consuming an ever increasing amount of material goods, and many countries are actually producing in absolute terms more material goods than ever. The rise in the share of services happened mainly because services are becoming relatively more expensive. Just think about it. I mean, the relative price between, say, a haircut and a computer has haircut and computer has risen enormously in the last 20, 30 years. Huh? You know, the price of your haircut is more or less the same as 20 years ago. I mean, taking into account inflation. Yeah? Price of computers, you know, with the money that you had to pay to buy a kind of decent computer 20 years ago, I mean, you can now buy four computers that are more powerful than that. Yeah? So the relative prices of computers have fallen enormously. And exactly because it's very difficult to raise productivity in services like haircut and, you know, restaurant and taxi driving and so on, the relative prices of these things have gone up. Yeah? So it's not because we are producing less material things than before. It's not because we are producing less of those things than before that the share of services have gone up. It's mainly the price effect. Okay, there are some countries like the United Kingdom where the absolute amount of industrial production has fallen. Yeah? But in most countries, in the United States, in Sweden, in Finland, it has actually risen in the last couple of decades. Eh? Secondly, a lot of recent productivity growth in services has been really an illusion. Eh? The high productivity growth in the financial sector in the 90s and early years of 2000s was actually based on dubious asset valuation and even some in some areas of sheer fraud. You know? And how shaky this was already proven by the 2008 financial crisis. At least in countries like the US and Britain, a lot of increase in retail sector productivity has been bought by lowering the quality of the retail service itself. So yes, I mean, retail companies are producing more output in the sense that they are selling more per employee than before, but a lot of this is in fact paid for by the customer. Because now they have to, you know, I mean, in the old days, you walk into a shoe shop and there'll be someone to see you in 2 minutes. Yeah? Now in countries like Britain or America, you go into a shoe shop, you take a ticket out, you wait for 25 minutes before anyone comes to you. Yeah? They built all this at huge supermarkets outside the city. You have to drive like 30 minutes. You have to walk long, long corridors. Yeah, you might be paying less for your apples and frozen pizzas, but actually you have to consume huge amount of fuel and time to do that. Yeah? So actually you are paying for it. Yeah? Of course, the company now sells a lot more. Yeah? So that's the illusion. Yeah? Thirdly, most high-valued services like finance, engineering, IT, consulting, they mainly sell to the manufacturing sector, so they cannot prosper without a strong manufacturing base. Of course, you can export these services to an extent, but there's a limit. Yeah? There's a well-known evidence showing that co-location of manufacturing and services is quite important, yeah? Meaning they have to be in close by places. Yeah? But then how about Switzerland? How about Singapore? Huh? Well, let me tell you how about them. Yeah? but I'll do it in a roundabout way. You know, this this movie, very old movie, older than I am, 1949, called The Third Man. This is a movie about, well, basically black marketing the antibiotics, mainly penicillin at the time, in Vienna, right after the Second World War. And in the movie, the leading role is taken by the legendary American actor Orson Welles, who actually appears as an evil character called Harry Lime. And there's a scene where Harry Lime, namely Orson Welles, is exposed as an evil guy, actually the drug lord of this the black market. And suddenly, Harry Lime launches himself into a diatribe, basically trying to argue that evil is good. Yeah? When did being nice and so on do any good? Yeah? So this is how he puts it. He says, in Italy, under the Borgias, you had all the bad things about human nature. Huh? Murder, terror, bloodshed, but they gave us the Renaissance. Huh? In Switzerland, they had 500 years of brotherly love and peace. What did they give it? What did they give us? The cuckoo clock. Yeah. Yeah, this is the image that most people have about Switzerland. You know, it's a boring country where they, I don't know, make money by taking care of black money deposited by third world dictators, or making and selling tacky souvenirs like cuckoo clocks and cowbells to American and Japanese tourists. Yeah? Well, if you want to be nice, there is a post-industrial economy. Yeah? They have become rich on the basis of services like banking and tourism. Yeah? Well, actually, very interestingly, this short three sentences includes five falsehoods. It must be something of a record. Yeah? How can you hide so many untruth in these three short sentences? Huh? Well, first of all, 500 years of democracy, what democracy? Huh? I don't know about other people, but I don't call a country where half the population cannot vote a democracy. Huh? Yeah, I mean, they gave women voting only in 1971. Actually, 1991, if you count these two rogue cantons which refused to do that. Yeah? Well, 500 years of peace, not quite true. They had a few wars with neighbors. Neither is it true that they had 500 years of brotherly love. They had no less than four civil wars in a span of 200 years in the 17th and the 19th century. And the cuckoo clock was not invented in Switzerland. It was invented in Germany. And finally, it's not this service economy. It is literally the most industrialized country in the world. Yeah? Look at these figures. In terms of per capita output of manufacturing, Switzerland is by far the highest in the world. Yeah? And very interestingly, another supposedly service-based economy, Singapore, is number two. You know, Switzerland produces on per capita basis 77% more manufactured goods than the United States. And we think it's a service economy. Yeah? Well, I mean, this is partly because the country is very small, you know, the 8 million people, so even if it produces a huge amount in per capita terms, you don't see many made in Switzerland products. Another reason is it specializes in what economists call producer goods. Yeah? Machine tools, measuring the professional measuring equipment, industrial chemicals. So in terms of consumer goods, they don't produce that much. Yeah? Okay, I mean, there's Nestle, yeah? Food products, there's a few pharmaceutical companies, but that's about it. Yeah? You're not going to see many made in Switzerland things, but on per capita basis, it's the most industrialized country in the world. Yeah? And the other supposed service success story, India, is also not what you think it is. You know, until the people are already talking about the India success in service export in the 1990s, but until 2003, India had actually trade deficit in services. Only in 2004, it started running trade surplus in services. But between 2004 and 11, India's service trade surplus was equivalent only to 0.9% of GDP, which covered only 17% of its merchandise trade deficit. Yeah? So merchandise is manufactured goods plus, say, food and the oil and things like that. This means that unless it increases its service trade surplus by 6 times, an implausible scenario, India cannot maintain its current pace of economic development without a serious balance of payment problem. Okay, having set out why these theories that say that we don't need to worry about production are problematic, we can still ask, okay, I mean, that maybe they are theoretically wrong, but does it really matter? Well, I would say it has mattered great deal because it has basically had many negative consequences, namely the neglecting production. So neglect of productive capabilities has made a lot of people think that what countries produce to earn their income does not matter. In the 1980s, there was a big debate on whether the United States should use Japanese-style industrial policy to fight off Japanese competition. And a lot of free market economists said, well, it actually doesn't really matter what you produce. Yeah? I mean, the most famous phrase was that it doesn't matter whether you produce potato chips or microchips, yeah? As far as you produce a lot of them. Yeah? So this kind of thinking has made a lot of developing countries complacent about their dependency on primary commodities or cheap assembly. Yeah, in the short run, it might make sense. Yeah? I mean, why should it matter that we are earning actually more money by exporting garments than by exporting high-tech products? But in the long run, this matters because different economic activities give different scope for growth and technological development in the long run. So even from a purely growth-oriented point of view, this line of thinking is problematic. The reason why countries like South Korea got into steel, electronics, automobile when the World Bank said that you guys are crazy. No, seriously, I mean, in the 1960s, Hyundai, the South Korean car company, they're producing 6 cars a day. Yeah? And then they wanted to do it. The government supported it. Everyone thought they were crazy. Yeah? But the South Koreans knew that if they keep producing things like cheap garment and Nike shoes and so, which they were actually specializing in at the time, they'd have no future. Yeah? Yes, I mean, Sri Lanka had export processing zones before Thailand and Korea. But because they just stopped there, it's a very poor country. Korea and Taiwan, yes, started with export processing zones, but they knew that sooner or later they'll have to move into electronics, automobiles, steel, and things like that. So what you do actually has a very, important implications for your future. Also, the neglect of productive capabilities has meant that our assessment for policies have acquired short-term biases. You know, development of productive capabilities takes a long time. You know, it took the Japanese 40 years of protection before they became competitive in the car manufacturing. Koreans did it a bit faster, but they still needed 30 years. So when you do not consider how difficult this thing is, of course, in the short run, these policies look crazy. yeah, why should you buy less good and more expensive cars made by your own domestic producer like Hyundai when you could be importing American and Japanese cars which are better and cheaper? Huh? It's madness. But in the long run, that's what you need. And unfortunately, when you don't think like that, the policies become very short-term oriented. The neglect of the collective dimension of productive development has also made people ignore the issues of how to develop modern firms and other institutions that are central to productive development. As I mentioned this earlier. Of course, there are talks of private sector development, but this is mainly a negative agenda in the sense that it says that basically, the private sector will develop if the government deregulates and cut taxes. There's no realization that private sector development requires a lot more. You know, institution building, developing of productive enterprises, you know, developing of enterprise networks. Also, the neglect of production has led to a very partial view of our individual well-being, because people are basically seen as consumers. Work is neglected. Work is seen as a disutility that people have to put up with so that they can earn money with which they can buy things whose consumption gives them ultimate goal in life. So what happens at the workplace is another concern in this discourse. And unfortunately, this has led to deterioration in the quality of our work life in many countries in the recent period. So the work is more intensive, there's a greater psychological pressure, there's less job security, so people are less happy even if they might be earning slightly more money than they used to 10 years ago. So given these negative consequences of neglecting production, I argue that we need to reconstruct our discourse on economic development by bringing production back in. Hence the title of the talk. Of course, that this is not to suggest that we go back to the older productionist tradition of the 1960s. We need to incorporate the more recent theoretical developments. First of all, we need to incorporate the insights from the humanist tradition and pay greater attention to non-material aspects of development. And the UNDP has been doing great work in this respect, emphasizing it's not just about money, it's about freedom, equality, individual developments, solidarity, community, many other things. Emphasizing the production aspect should not mean neglecting individuals. We need to take individuals more seriously, but not just as consumers, as in the neoliberal economics, nor just as citizens with entitlement, as in the humanist approach, but also as producers, in whose life employment and the contents of their work are very important dimensions. Thirdly, reflecting the recent developments in the economics of technology and in institutional economics, we need to improve our theory of production itself with attention paid not just to technologies, but to the role of organizations, institutions, culture, and even politics in the process of the development of productive capabilities. And last but not least, environmental sustainability has to be incorporated into our thinking. You know, contrary to the conventional wisdom, development of productive capabilities, especially in the manufacturing sector, is crucial in preventing and adapting to climate change. Yes, it is true that the past effort that industrialization has created this climate change problem. But we are not going to solve this simply by asking people to living a more sustainable lifestyle. I mean, we have to do that, but there's a limit to what you can do. The Europeans find it easier to feel virtuous about cycling to work, but if you're some guy stuck in the suburb in Texas, you're not going to cycle 70 miles to your work, are you? Yeah? So that this involves the long-term planning about the urban environment, public transport. It has to be done, but it cannot be done overnight. So how are you going to deal with this? You basically need to come up with viable renewable energy technologies quickly. You need to invest in the building capabilities to deal with the consequences of climate change. So the developing productive capabilities is actually a very important part of preventing and adapting to climate change. And given that they are the ones with the necessary technological capabilities, the rich countries need to further develop their productive capabilities in the area of green technologies. Because however much they might need those technologies, most developing countries do not have the capabilities to develop these technologies. Yes, there's China, there's Brazil, but a few other countries even have the ability to develop them. So a lot of these have to be created in the developed countries and transferred at affordable prices to developing countries. And when it comes to developing countries, even just to cope with the adverse consequences of climate change, they need to develop the technological and organizational capabilities, many of which can only be acquired through the industrialization process. Let me give you one very good example. Several years ago, there was this famous earthquake in Haiti, which killed 200,000 people. And the country still hasn't recovered from that. That earthquake was 7 on Richter scale. Japan has a Richter scale 7 earthquake every other week. Maybe one person dies, maybe two person dies. So it's not because Haiti had a strong earthquake that it had this devastating consequence. It's because Japan had the technological and organizational capabilities to mitigate the impact of these earthquakes. Yeah, so they have the technologies to build these the tall buildings which have a flexible foundation. So even if the earth is shaking, the buildings are going to collapse. They have all this very well worked out evacuation plan that requires practice for everyone regularly. This is how they prevent the consequences of the earthquake. It's not because Japan has a weaker earthquake. Of course, even Japan cannot survive Richter scale 9 earthquake, as we have seen, but So this is a great example showing how the same the kind of environmental impact can have very different consequences depending on the technological and organizational capabilities possessed by the country that is hit by those impacts. And this means that developing countries need to acquire those capabilities, and many of these can only be acquired through industrialization. Your service sector is not going to create the technologies to build those kind of buildings that the Japanese built. Okay, so let me conclude. Developing and enriching the traditional productionist view of economic development with the addition of these new elements, drawing on the humanist tradition, economics of technology, institutional economics, and so on. This will not be easy, but I think it's absolutely necessary if you are to promote more rapid, but economically and environmentally more sustainable economic development in the future. Thank you very much.